I was kind of getting dizzy watching you play because how you managed to put all of that together. It's quite. There's a lot going on there.
Well, you're a big inspiration with that.
Oh, really,
Martin? Yes, the way you do, you know, three parts at once and play with each part and phrase each part.
Yeah, so. But I've only got six strings. How many have you got there?
20. Used to have 21, but one broke here, and so.
All right.
I ended up. I kind of liked it better without that one string, so I just left it off. But I learned that arrangement from Claude Laflamme in Canada. I do almost all my own arrangements, so this is the rare exception. He has a 21-string harp guitar, and I thought, well, that takes... it's really a great use of all the range of the harp guitar, so I learned that from him. But he has one more string than I have, and so where I run out of strings, believe it or not, for the arrangement, when I need a higher note.
I was going to ask you that.
I grab it as a harmonic, and it's a little hard to find, so I have to. It's a very precise point.
That's what really got me, because this note was an octave higher than I would expect it.
I just barely touch it and try to find that center point. So I have to kind of eyeball it here. And if I have my head a little different place, it looks a little different. So it's a bit of a guess where it is.
That's hard. That's. It's lovely to see you again. Last time we worked together was in Japan. We were in Tokyo at the Cotton Club, and we had such a good time there. And I love to hear you play, and to hear you playing this instrument again. I've heard you play the harp guitar many, many times, and what I like about the way you play is it's all about the music.
Oh yeah.
You know, it's just you use the instrument really just to express. Your musical ideas. You're not, you don't do things just for the sake. Well, I've got all these strings and I'm going to do this. Just all of a sudden, a nice bass note comes in. It really gets you.
Well, Stephen Bennett was a big influence. When I first got my harp guitar, I was here at the Chet Atkins convention, and Stephen Bennett was the only one playing harp guitar at that time that I knew. And I asked him, "Well, what do I do with all these bass strings?" And he said, "Well, only add one when it adds to the music. Otherwise, you can just stay on this part. You don't have to play this part." And that was freeing to me. So then just only approach it musically. And that's why I got a harp guitar in the first place, was because I was making these arrangements and compositions that were calling for these low-ringing bass notes. I was reaching for a note that wasn't on my guitar.
So do you feel, with the harp guitar, that you found your musical voice?
Yes, I really do.
Was that there was something not there with the regular guitar for you that this could offer you?
Right. I kept on yearning for that low note and went out seeking one.
But you did this too, where you suddenly got these super high notes as well.
Well, I got one with the high notes, super trebles, as we call them.
Super trebles.
Yes. After I recorded the harp guitars under the stars with John Doane, and he has one with a super treble, so it would say double harp guitar. See, I think it's the first time that we've done that. I think a harp guitar duet CD has come out, as far as we know.
Yeah.
So that's a lot of strings by the time you put together two harp guitars.
I did record a track with Steve Howe when we recorded the Scott Chinnery guitar collection.
Okay.
And he had a whole selection of vintage harp guitars, and we just recorded a track together, and okay, let's see what happens. And we recorded all of these. I don't know how many strings we had in the end, but we recorded about five or six of them. And I seem to remember one of them even had three necks on it. I can't remember it, but very, very old. And we just had so much fun. Some of them we tuned one to a chord, and that was it, and then just started to add on top of that and see where it took us.
Yeah.
That would be very interesting for you to do multi-tracked
harp guitar. Yes.
Can I put in a request there?
Yes, so that sounds very interesting. I have not done that. I've done it live together with John, with two harp guitars.
The track we did was called Harpnosis.
Oh, yes. I'm going to have to look that up now.
Yeah.
Okay, I have a mission when we finish this.
But the thing that actually attracted me to the harp guitar, when the old Gibson harp guitars, many years ago, I saw one hanging up in a store in, I think it was in Portland, Oregon or somewhere, and I just saw this guitar and I thought, I want one of them. I don't know what I'm going to do with it, but it just seemed so cool, all those low notes and everything. And so it's good to see somebody championing this instrument.
And how about you? Have you been doing anything with a harp guitar?
No, but I'd like to. I'd like to. I'm watching you playing this. I need to get one.
Okay.
Maybe we can look into that. So what I was going to ask you, first of all, I was talking the other day about my earliest memories, and actually not my earliest musical memories so much, but although it was a musical memory, was when I was about 3 years old, my dad brought into the house a little ukulele. And that was not only my first musical memory, it was my first memory. So my first memory is actually playing a stringed instrument.
Wow.
So what are your early musical memories, and what was it that set you on this path?
Well, my mother claims it was prenatal, because she would play the piano with her tummy up against the soundboard, up against the side of the piano, so mm-hmm. I could feel the vibrations. And so she says that feeling those vibrations even as an infant.
So your mom played piano. Did all your family play music?
Everyone does something for fun.
Yeah.
And I'm the only one crazy enough to do it as an occupation, other than my grandfather.
All right.
My grandfather played saxophone in John Philip Sousa's band.
Did he?
Yes.
Oh, what a fantastic part of your family history.
Yes, and then had his own dance band after that.
So
my grandfather was a big influence, just because I thought that playing music for a living was the coolest thing anyone could do.
I'll tell my bank manager that next time I see him. I'm sure he'll appreciate that.
That's right.
But the music you listened to, first of all, you know, what was the music that was in the house?
Folk music. So.
Where did you grow up?
I grew up in the suburbs of Chicago, and my parents loved classical music, but I never really took to classical music. I was the one out of the four kids who didn't really.
Why do you think that was?
I liked music that was fun.
Okay.
You know, and
did you want music that you could move around a little?
Yes, right. And I liked to play around with things. And I remember when I got my first guitar, the friend of the family was just throwing it away, and so I started figuring out melodies on it, and then I heard the crickets playing, so I started going on the string and see if I could play a duet with the crickets. And so I was about 8 years old. So I like to listen to the music in nature, the music around me, and make music together. So even as a soloist, I'm trying to keep my ears open and follow the phrasing as it leads me, and follow the music around me.
Was the guitar the first instrument then?
Piano.
That's
yes, and so I took piano lessons for years. You know, we had to take it, and then when I got to college and enrolled, I actually didn't pass the beginning piano requirement.
Yeah, really?
Yes.
You're having too much fun.
I was not a good piano student, and so I majored then in guitar performance, and so. So guitar was my second instrument, but that was what I did for fun. I never had to practice the guitar.
It's still all I do for fun.
Yeah, me too. There we go.
That's the way it's got to be, isn't it?
Yes.
Really. I was here with John Knowles, and we were talking about this, and I asked him advice, any advice that he'd want to give anybody, and he gave a great piece of advice, something that I've always felt. He said, when you play, imagine, even if you're just in a room on your own, that you're the audience, that you're playing for this audience.
Yes.
And that makes you really focus on playing, because if you're just playing, you're just on your own, you're playing the guitar and you're going through everything, you're not actually doing a performance. Even when I practice as such, if you call it practicing, then it's actually a performance for me. I'm trying to play it as I would for an audience, but also how I would feel in the audience hearing that music. And it's a great way of actually listening, playing music, and making sure that you listen to what you're playing. Because mm-hmm. very often, it's something I've worked with my students a lot, very often they don't actually listen to themselves properly. Because, and it's understandable, because they're so busy in just figuring out what they're doing and trying to do it right,
okay.
that their ears can sometimes switch off. How did you, you know, when you started working on pieces, how did you kind of approach that? Did you imagine that you were playing for an audience, or?
I was very much the listener as well as the
that's
performer.
What I mean, yeah.
So yes, and you've really hit something that's ultimately important, and kind of the way I've approached music. And I'm one who never did practice for hours and hours on end.
Me neither.
You need to, oh, that's no, great.
Sorry, I got to put my hands
yeah,
up.
I know.
In here I did. I
yes.
practiced a lot, constantly, sometimes too much in my head. I couldn't concentrate what was going on around me because I had all this music going on in my head.
Right, but I was listening as I was playing and enjoying the music that was coming out. And so I think that approaching it like that, and also approaching it kind of like a game, like say, okay, why can't I play this? Maybe it's because I need to do this or this, or this or this, and then it's a puzzle, and it's a fun puzzle to try to solve. And so when you have, you know, the combination of this puzzle that you're solving with you know, how are you going to make this arrangement or make this F chord? You can't do whatever level it is. I think the combination of those two things help you to learn a lot quicker, and it's a lot more fun.
Well, I thought of something that came to my mind a little while ago. In order for us to really, really enjoy our playing, and when we enjoy our playing, it means we improve, we get better. In order to do that, we need to become our own biggest fan. We need to love our playing.
Yes.
And I think that's something we need to try and cultivate, to actually love our playing, become our fan, our number one fan. Yeah, I love the way I'm doing this.
It's exciting when you're doing, oh, cool, it's coming out like that.
Then once you do that, if you start to love what you're playing, then how can you expect members of the audience, people listening to you play, if you're playing, oh, I'm not really sure about this, and I don't know, I shouldn't have done this, I shouldn't have done that. That is going to convey a kind of negative message to the listener.
Well, I think you're right. And the other thing that is interesting to think of is to try to capture something in the music. So once you've, you know, gotten to a certain point, then you want to capture a feeling, you want to capture an image, you want to capture the sound of another instrument.
Mm-hmm.
You want to imitate something. So there's all sorts of different things that you can capture. But with each song, I'm trying to capture something unique in there. That's what makes it fun for me. So I don't just play the notes. There's something unique.
Mm.
Like this Japanese tune, the Sakura. So
oh,
when I'm playing that, it's really on a regular guitar. So I'm trying to capture that sound of the koto.
Yeah. That's Japan right there. Yeah, yeah.
Sorts of different techniques I can use to
I remember you playing this when we played in Japan together.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, you really wowed the audience with with that.
But the thing is, if I'm playing just this theme, if I play it just straight, it's just the notes. But what I do is I do a combination of like a rock and roll vibrato, you know, up and down, and a back and forth vibrato, like the classical vibrato.
Yeah.
Play near the bridge here, play with the very tips of the fingernails, and then hold back in the timing, because I'm thinking about that Japanese culture that's a little bit polite, and so I want to hold back just a little bit politeness, and then all those things together. Sudden you're in Japan.
Yeah.
So it was the fun discovery to say, okay, how do I capture that feeling of being in Japan?
We're storytellers. That's really what we're doing
yes.
when it comes down to it. We're telling yeah, we're telling stories, we're painting pictures, you know, with it's stories without words. But I think that as well. When I play a set, or if I play a show, actually the way I do my set list is such a way that it's kind of going on a journey. Do you do that when you put a set list together? Do you give that much thought?
I do give a lot of thought, and I also do it a little different for every show. It kind of depends on what I'm feeling the audience is looking for. And I'm putting together an audiovisual show now, so very much trying to tell a story with it. So putting images behind that. So I'm working with Brian Allen, the great photo artist who did my Nightlight Daylight CD. Mm. And he's doing images behind on a screen, projected behind me.
This is something that really interests me, actually.
Yes. And so the challenge is to get the balance between not too interesting that everyone's just looking at the screen and is not listening to the music or focused on the artist, you know, and then also, you know, beautiful and interesting imagery that matches the song. So it's a combination of that and how to work it to create that perfect mesh where you have a complete product with a performer and the visual.
Mm. So this is a direction you've been. I know a few other musicians as well that are going in a very similar direction to this, of actually working with visuals, and it's something that does interest me. I'm a little worried about it because I like you say, if it detracts from the music, it's a little like I don't know. There's a proliferation of flat screens everywhere we go,
yes,
in public places,
yes,
now.
Right.
Restaurants and bars all have screens everywhere. And there's something about us, we're instantly drawn to it.
Mm-hmm.
When I had my guitar festival in Scotland, we used to have two screens, big screens either side. And then sometimes there'd be somebody playing, a guitar player playing right in front of everybody, but everyone was looking at watching the screen,
yes,
rather than actually watching the player. It's just something that seems to be we're drawn towards those. So it's got to be something that is, as you say, you're working with Brian, you must have a great empathy with him. He must understand your music and in a deeper way,
a very deep way. And in fact, when I was looking for an artist for years for my Nightlight Daylight CD, because I had this idea of the CD that lights up. And I had the idea in 2005, and I'd been kind of keeping my eye out for an artist since then.
Mm.
And Phil Keggy, my good friend, sent me a picture just with nothing attached to it. He'd never done that before, just an email. And it was called The Lightning Catchers. It was a farmer catching lightning in a field, and his wife is out there with a lightning rod, and he's putting it into bottles and putting it on a wheelbarrow. And I looked at the mastery of light in that, and the humor and the intrigue, and I said, that has everything in it that is my music. I'd never seen anything like that before. And then I found it, that was Brian Allen, and I went to his website and I looked at all his images, were saying my music exactly. And so that's why I hired him, and we indeed found very much of an empathy.
I've really got to catch one of your shows.
Yeah,
doing that. So, tell me again. We're going to go back a little bit here.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about your influences, not necessarily guitar players too, just musical influences that. All the things that happened influenced you, well, not everything, obviously, but anything that kind of comes to your mind that makes you who you are today as the person, as the musician.
Well, I mean, there's so many influences. Bluegrass was a big one. I played in a bluegrass band for 6 years, and I loved fiddle music. I still do to this day.
Mm-hmm.
And and folk music, we sang around the house. I went to the Old Town School of Folk Music, and that was
Old Town, yeah.
Yeah, my stomping grounds there. And I think, you know, going to those bluegrass festivals, I hung around with Bill Monroe's rhythm player, Wayne Lewis, and just I loved his feel, and just, you know, learned from him how to push that timing. And so my default rhythm is up to the front of the beat, right, to propel the band. So that's what I worked on, that rhythm. And so it was a big influence, as opposed to starting with blues, where your default rhythm is way to the back of the beat.
Yeah.
You know? And
a lot of jazz like that.
Right, right. And so if I'm playing that, I have to really pull back my default rhythm and really, really think about it. Because where you place the beat is, you know, very much different depending on the tune.
Yeah, and I mean, bluegrass, when I listen to bluegrass, coming from the British Isles as I do and live most of my life in Scotland,
yeah.
I listen to bluegrass music straight away, you know, when I first came to the States with Stephen Grappelli, touring with him, and we were working with David Grisman, and although David wasn't playing bluegrass music, but then I became exposed to that music, and everyone was playing tunes, and I thought, I know that tune. You know,
oh,
and it
yes.
would be, yeah, it would be, but they had different names.
Scottish and
American. Obviously, that's where it comes from. And actually, I've worked with quite a number of Scottish jazz musicians who have a way of playing time that is a little bit on top of the beat.
Okay.
It's not behind the beat, okay. as I play more of kind of when I play jazz, it's more of an American style where I play behind everything. A little, and I noticed a lot of musicians that I've worked with in Scotland, playing jazz, had that on top feel all the time. So
yeah.
I saw that connection,
yeah,
between the music.
The Pat Metheny Group was also a great influence.
Of course.
I loved I couldn't believe that music could be so beautiful when I first got the albums. Likewise with the Paul Winter Consort.
Mm-hmm.
And I love what Paul Winter did with playing music with animals, you know, with animal melodies.
All right.
Well.
Yes.
So my favorite tune was Wolf Eyes, a duet between a Canadian mountain wolf and a soprano saxophone.
So if you look at your development as a musician, and of course it's always ongoing, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, yes.
It's just a constant thing that happens. And there'll be guitar players watching this who are at different parts of their journey. You're at a certain stage of your journey.
Mm-hmm.
I'm at another stage of mine, and we kind of meet along the way. So you'll have some guitar players maybe are kind of early on in their journey or have been playing for quite a while. But as a very prolific musician, is there any kind of advice that you would give? Is there something that you say, this is a key thing that I've always kept to that has been central to my music?
When I find something that really inspires me, I try to figure out what is it about that grabs me. And then it could be the harmony, it could be the where the beat is placed, like we were talking about. It could be just a nuance, like in Close to You. What grabbed me was where
I love you playing that.
Oh, thank you.
Would you do it? Would you play it for it? We'll talk
okay.
about it and play
right.
it. I'd love to hear
I'll
you play
play
that.
I'll talk about it while I play
yeah,
it. But
yeah, okay.
I've never done it on harp guitar, so I'll see.
All right, okay. Well, I've set you a challenge.
Now, what intrigues me is where the piano places that little middle chunking.
Yeah.
So you can hear the piano chunking, chunk, chunk, like that.
Got it.
So to capture that, while Karen Carpenter sings freely over that. So a combination of chunks and that free melody over it.
And you've got those dynamics. You've got it slightly quieter than everything else. It's just
yes.
underneath.
It's kind of a dippy part, so to undippify it, I do it as harmonics. So it makes it a little more interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's that little piano line.
Yeah. You cannot do that song without that.
Yeah. play a little softer there to kind of get
yeah.
that feel. Now, I used to go up a half step, but why? I'm not singing, I'm doing as an instrumental, so I'm changing to a G instead of a C sharp.
I see.
Now I get open strings. It messes up singers if they're trying to sing along with me. Get back to where I was. That's it for the ending. I take this little part, different bass note, work the bass note, and then I'm miraculously back to the original key.
Exactly.
I'm really proud of that.
I'm proud of
spread out those chords and make it sound like
yeah.
a chorus. Kind of arpeggiate them ever
yeah.
so slightly. Now I pretend like I was Burt Bacharach here and I just wrote this part with a little descending bass line.
Really Burt Bacharach there, you throw in a 5/4 bar when you don't expect it.
Oh, that's right.
It would add, suddenly add beats.
Oh, yeah, he did some really sophisticated things.
Very, yeah.
Musically, you know,
I do,
tucked him in there, yeah.
Something that is a similar kind of concept to this, because I was thinking of Frank Sinatra with the Count Basie Orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
They did the at the Sands in Las Vegas,
yeah.
And you've got the Basie Orchestra, but there was the great Freddie Green playing rhythm, you know, like you're doing the piano part
yeah.
there. You know, the Basie
yeah.
Orchestra. You know, that kind of Basie Orchestra. Then Sinatra singing behind the beat. Similar in
yeah.
a way.
Yeah, really big.
So it's having that, like you were doing there, where you've got that solid rhythm, but then you're playing Karen Carpenter or Sinatra singing on the top, really, really laid back.
Yeah.
But also those internal dynamics where you've got that melody singing out really strong and everything underneath.
Yes, pulls back.
Yeah, I work a lot on that with my students. Not playing everything in the same with the same volume,
right.
or with the same tone, or texture. It's funny. We were playing two different styles of music there,
mm-hmm.
but it's the same language.
Yes,
in a way, isn't
yes.
it? Really. So what are you? I know we're both in Nashville right now, but what have you got happening? What's exciting at the moment? You've got, I know you've got a new CD.
Well, that was just really, it's a double CD of music to wake up to and music to go to sleep to. And it was all really from the heart. I wrote the Nightlight music and arranged it for my best friend's first baby. It was music to go to sleep to. And then when he had a second baby, I thought, well, the second baby needs music to wake up to then. And so that was the beginning of what turned into Nightlight Daylight. And it's the first one that actually, we had talked about the front cover. And I have some wonderful players with here.
I'm just seeing some, wow. You got Victor Wooten, Bill Keeghy, Danny Gottlieb, Howard Levy, wonderful. Stanley Jordan, Tommy Emmanuel, and Earl Clue. You couldn't get anyone any good, could you?
Well, I couldn't find you that time. You're the only one who's missing from there.
Why didn't you call me? So are you going to open, you can show me something here?
Yes. We have the text is on the shrink wrap, so you get two front covers, and that's the music to wake up to. And I'm that third child flying on the dandelion seed, the music to go to sleep to. And then when you push the moon, it lights up, and then there's a shooting star at the end.
Isn't that great?
So it's between the packaging and the music. It's won 11 awards now. I think we placed first.
11 awards.
Yeah, we placed first in our category in all of them. So somebody is feeling, I think, what went into it.
That is absolutely beautiful. Oh, wow, look at this.
And inside there's a bonus track, which is What the World Needs Now is Love. And when you're finished with that, and that download code,
you get
four guitar picks out of it. Yeah, it turns into four guitar picks.
You're a genius. That's quite
something. So there's a lot of detail that went into putting that together.
And where can we get one of these?
You can, a lot of places. The best place is just going to my website, murielanderson.com, there's a bunch of ways you can get it there.
This is great.
It's in stores in Japan also.
Great. Well, thank you, Muriel. It's been a pleasure, as always, to just sit down and play some music with you and listen to you play and hear your words of wisdom. Thanks for that. I'm so pleased to see you again. We've got to go back to Japan again sometime soon. I enjoyed that.
That was
so much. Let's play something that we played when we were in Tokyo. I'm going to try and play along with what you're doing here. I'm just so pleased to spend this time here with Muriel here in Nashville, and thank Muriel for sharing this with us today.
I have a secret to tell you, though.
What's that?
Okay, so after you left in Japan, you checked out of the hotel,
and
I was still there for another day.
You paid my bar bill.
And no, inside your room, you had left all of your breakfast coupons.
Really?
Yes, you didn't have breakfast early in the morning.
I'm not a breakfast person. No.
So the chambermaid gave me the breakfast coupons, and I had three breakfasts. I just went right from one to the next to the next. When one breakfast place closed,
I hope you were thinking of me. When
that's right. I went with my friend. Yeah.
Okay, I'll forgive
Mariko,
you.
Mariko, and the two of us, we had a wonderful.
Hey,
triple
breakfast on me.
Yeah.
Let's play this tune.
All right.
Well, you play it, and I'll just try not to get in your way too much.
How about Imagine?
Thank you.
thank you.
Thank you.
Muir Landerson.